for September.
September to order and recognize special guests we have this evening with us, members of our city council. And we have Mr. Bert Snitz, who is the CEO of WHRO, and Mr. Brian Callahan, who manages programming and telecommunications for us at WHRO. We welcome all of you this evening to our meeting as special guests. And of course, we do have quite a number of other people here from staff, and we're always glad to see you. Look as though you've survived the first 2 weeks of school. Lots of smiles on your faces, and we appreciate that. We need to see the students, don't we? All right, so at this time, I'd like to ask that you join us in the Pledge of Allegiance, and a student from S.P. Morton is supposed to lead the pledge, and Mr. Chandler, are you doing an introduction of the student?
I apologize at the last minute. Our student was unable to attend, so I will be the student this evening. So if you will please rise and join me in the Pledge of Allegiance.
Thank you.
I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
Thank you. Certification by the school board regarding our closed session.
Whereas the Franklin City School Board has convened a closed meeting on this date pursuant to an affirmative recorded vote and in accordance with the provisions of the Virginia Freedom of Information Act, and whereas section 2.2-3712.D of the Code of Virginia requires a certification by the school board that such closed meeting was conducted in conformity with Virginia law. Now, therefore, be it resolved that the Franklin City School Board hereby certifies that to the best of each member's knowledge, only public business matters lawfully exempted by Virginia law were discussed in the closed meeting to which this certification applies, and only such public business matters as were identified in the motion convening the closed meeting were heard, discussed, or considered.
Second.
It has been properly moved and second that the Franklin City School Board has convened in a closed meeting on this date pursuant to the affirmative recorded vote in accordance with the provisions of the Virginia Freedom of Information Act, and whereas section 2.2-312D of the Code of Virginia requires a certification by this school board that such closed meeting was conducted in conformity with Virginia law. Now, therefore, be it resolved that the Franklin City School Board has hereby certifies that to the best of each member's knowledge that we only acted on items 1 and D as indicated. You've heard the motion. Is there any discussion? Hearing none. All in favor?
Aye.
Aye. The motion is carried. Thank you. Roll call.
Mr. Robert Holt?
Here.
Ms. Nancy Godwin?
Here.
Ms. Ferda Jackson?
Here.
Dr. Andrea Hall-Leonard?
Present.
Ms. Edna King?
Here.
Ms. Jeanette Alston?
Here.
Mr. Will Council?
Thank you. So there are six of us here this evening, and Mr. Council announced that he would not be able to attend this evening. We understand he had a work-related responsibility. And I need to apologize to the board because we talked about this motion that almost haunts us to come out of the closed session. So it's on the agenda. Would you please, someone, read that?
Make a motion to come out of closed session?
I second.
It's properly moved and second that we come out of the closed session. You heard the motion. Is there any discussion? Hearing none. All in favor?
Aye.
Aye. Opposed. The motion is carried. Approval of the agenda, and I'd like to ask that we reorder items on the agenda by allowing special recognition that is on our agenda under good news, and that of presentations by members of WHRO staff. We'll do that first under good news. Are there any questions about that? Right? So, could I get an approval of the agenda considering the reordering of the items?
So moved.
It has been properly moved and second that we approve our
agenda. I second.
Was there a second?
A second.
You second? Okay, thank you. So we're probably moved in second that we approve our agenda with the entirety with the reordering of those two indicated items. You've heard the motion. Any in discussion? Hearing none. All in favor?
Aye.
Aye. The opposition? Any? Opposed? Motion is carried. Thank you. Right, Dr. Bell, so would you just proceed from there, please?
Madam Chair, board members, at this time, we would like to recognize members of our city council, as well as our city manager, for the tireless work that they conducted and performed last school year in support of Franklin City Public Schools. At this time, tonight, we have present Mrs. Mary Hilliard, Mrs. Mona Murphy, and Mr. Randy Martin. Will you please come forward, and we would like to present you with a token of our appreciation. And the certificate reads, in recognition and deep appreciation for your faithful service, dedication and support provided to the school board, superintendent, administrative staff, employees, and most importantly, the children of Franklin City Public Schools. Given the 17th day of September 2015, Dr. Willard J. Bell, Jr., superintendent, school board members, and the King Chair, and Dr. Andrea Hall Leonard, Vice Chair, Jeanette Austin, Nancy Garvin, Verna Jackson, Will Council, and Robert Hope. We thank you so much.
Thank you. We would like to indicate that we are most appreciative of all that you've done for our community, for our schools, and especially by serving our children. It was one major thing that you did for us, and you may smile while I'm talking. And that was the acquisition of QZAP funds, the resolution that you signed for us to acquire QZAP funds. Was most important. And you wouldn't even begin to realize how much it impacted the success of our students and their performance. When we looked at the performance and outcomes of our children this year, this past academic year, that is, we could not have done it without you and your support. Your support of those QZAP bonds and your signing of that resolution meant so very much to us and our children, and we thank you for that, especially all the other many things that you've done. We are also appreciative because you funded our budget for this ensuing school year, the one we're currently in, and we appreciate that. We didn't want this year to start without recognizing you because we had recognized the contributions of other people. And we left your recognition for this special moment. So we thank you for being here. And please express to our other city council persons how much we appreciate them. Thank you.
Thank you. Madam Chair, board yes. members, at this time, we would have, if we could adjust the monitor to screen for WHRO's presentation. Mm-hmm. Now we have the annual impact statement here, Bert, if you...
You have a hard copy.
I have a hard copy.
You want to project that out?
I'll just refer to the hard copy.
You just want to refer to it?
No, yeah, I don't need...
You sure?
Yep.
Okay.
Mrs. King, Dr. Bell, members of the board, thank you for allowing me to speak with you tonight. My name is Bert Schmidt. I am the president and CEO of WHRO, and with me is Brian Callahan, my vice president of education. So if you have any hard questions, he is here to back me up. And I appreciate being under good news. I don't usually get that kind of billing, but thank you for putting me under good news. I'm here tonight because you're one of the 19 school divisions that actually own WHRO. We're the only public TV and radio station in the entire country that's owned by a collaboration of public school divisions. And so we provide you each year an annual impact statement of the financial impact, both the monies you invest and the monies you save and get from WHRO. So I want to go through this briefly. I come to you every other year, so we get to see each other face-to-face, but you will get this report every year. And I'm going to go just through some highlights of the report very briefly with you. On the first page, 1 of 27, I want to recognize those folks who've been intimately involved with the station. Mrs. King has been your board rep for quite some time and has been working with us for decades, I would say. in various forms. So we really appreciate your leadership. Thank you so much, Mrs. King. And of course, Dr. Bell represents, works with the other superintendents throughout the region in helping us develop the products that you're going to hear about today. Everything I talk about today has been a request of the schools. I also want to highlight Anita Harris, who has been a longtime partner with WHRO, for all the work that she has done over many, many years. Not just with this division, but with many divisions, and a close partner to WHRO. On page 2, highlight a couple of educator resources. Under number 1, eMedia VA is an education portal. We created this portal for you. You own it. It costs you nothing. Today, we have over 100,000 digital learning objects. Video, audio, games, apps, lesson plans, things every one of your teachers can use to bring digital content into the classroom. We have partnerships at the national level with organizations like the Smithsonian, National Archives, Library of Congress, NASA, but perhaps even more importantly, we have relationships with Virginia organizations, all sorts of organizations across the state that have great things that teachers can use in the classroom. We partner with them, we bring them into one place. The teacher can search by SOL, by keyword, by subject matter, grade level, a variety of ways, and bring that digital, and they don't have to go out to 1,000 different websites to try to find stuff. It's all in one place. And it allows you to replace your DE streaming service, which of course was becoming very expensive. And this costs you nothing simply by being a member of WHRO. We do have a contract with the State Department of Education to make this free. We're in the fourth year of a 5-year contract, and we're having those conversations as we speak to renew that contract, which we fully expect to have happen. So eMedia VA, if some of your teachers are not aware of it, it's an important tool, and we are happy to provide you the marketing materials to make sure all of your teachers are aware of this service. The more they use, it doesn't cost you any more money, but the better your teachers can be. And number 2 on the same page, we have a professional development service called TeacherLine. It's an online training where your teachers can get graduate credit and recertifications. We have a relationship with James Madison University where you can get college credit, graduate credit, for even less than if you went to JMU. And so you can go to our TeacherLine site. Right, I think last year only one of your teachers took advantage of this, but there are opportunities for your teachers to get even more professional development. And on page 3, I'll briefly mention that we host a number of special topic forums at the station, and a number of your educators have come out to our Norfolk building, and we usually talk about things around educational technology, and so we'll bring folks from Apple or Microsoft or other technology companies in and help your teachers understand how to use technology in the classroom. Page 4, our student services. The first one, and one of the most important services we provide to you upon your request, is providing you with online courses. WHRO has created 24 online high school courses. We've created them and given them all to use however you want. So as you can see from the report in paragraph 2, we have given you Algebra 1, Trig, astronomy, biology, earth science, economics and personal finance, English 9, 10, 11, and 12, geometry, health and PE 9 and 10, oceanography, physics, U.S. history, U.S. and Virginia government, world geography, and world history 1 and 2. And this past year, we also added math analysis and chemistry, and soon we will be providing you with French and psychology. So those will be coming out fairly soon. So again, we make the courses, we give them to you, and you decide the policies on how you want to use those. Of course, you know your juniors have a requirement to take an online course to graduate high school. So you're not going to have a lot of the costs that some other schools around the state would have because you own online courses. Item number two, Virtual Virginia. You use Virtual Virginia very extensively for the size of this division. Over 120 of your students took a Virtual Virginia course. This is either advanced placement or world languages. It's a program that is owned by the Department of Education, but WHRO has run this program and operated this program from day one. So state owns it, we operate it. And you may know, not relevant to last year's report, but just starting 2 weeks ago, the state started a Virtual Virginia full-time pilot. We leased the state 13 of our core courses that you have, and now there are options for schools to put, for example, a homeschooler through the public school system. They can take all their courses online, and the school gets the ADM. So think about that. There's a great financial impact this can have as you put students who might have been outside the public school system, it's a way to bring them back in through Virtual Virginia. Something to really think about. The pilot is happening as we speak. There's 89 students in the initial pilot. But of course, it'll be a much larger program next year. Page five, some of the additional education resources we provide. I won't go through them all, but I want to highlight a couple of things. Again, we'll be doing the spelling bee this year. You've always had a student there at the bee. Be here locally will happen in the fall. I don't know the exact date you're doing it, but it happens in the fall. And then the regional B will happen in February at the station. The winner of that B goes on to nationals. So your students have always done quite well and represented the district quite well. We expect that to happen again. One item I would just point out to you, number four, the Great Computer Challenge. You have not been a part of that. This is a 30-year-old program, 30 years, I believe is the right number, 30 years. This is for kids K through 12, so all of your kids, and it's a competition, a team competition, where students compete around software applications and programs. They spend a full day on the campus of ODU, and it's competition, and there's a celebration, and there's trophies. It's just another opportunity for your smart kids, especially in the world of computers, to show off their skills. And we're happy to give you marketing materials to share with your appropriate teachers if you'd want to be a part of the Great Computer Challenge. And Anita knows something about that program. I'm going to skip a few pages just to help wrap things up. But I do want to mention, Dr. Bell, we'll be coming to you soon to get you on our air. Have we been out here yet to see you? We will. Look for that phone call because we're going to make you a star pretty soon. We'll get you on TV pretty soon. So start thinking about that now. On pages 7 and 8 are our pre-K services. I know that's not your real focus, but do know these are available for you. Again, it doesn't cost you any more money, everything I'm talking about. But for those who are involved in pre-K services, folks you know, folks that are involved, please let them know about these services. We did speak to some of your folks, and we have a schedule to come out with our Raising Readers van. You'll see item number 3. So that van will be out here. That's scheduled. I don't have the exact date, but that'll be coming out soon. And, of course, as board members, page 9 is probably what you care most about because you care about the financial situation. You'll note there that for the last school year, Franklin spent less than $4,000 and received in savings and value over $400,000. We hope you like that return on your investment. And with that, I'll take any questions you may have.
Questions, comments, anyone? Mm-hmm. I appreciate the fact that you looked at the Great Computer Challenge and I did note that as one of my areas of concern. And I think that not trying to defend, because I'm hoping that we, with the acquisition of a teacher in keyboarding and the technology teacher at the middle school, that probably this year we can have a team. I do believe that that acquisition, Dr. Bill, with that keyboarding teacher and the technology teacher, that we might likely be able to sponsor a team in computer challenge this year. The great, what did you say? Yes.
And you've got an expert right behind me who knows a lot more about it than anybody else in this room. So.
Right.
It is an awesome thing to be there.
It is. Yes, and that would be maybe the area that we could impact. I noted that in my notes with that acquisition of a keyboarding teacher, and then the technology teacher that we have at the middle school would be a perfect place for us to probably organize the team.
It's always nice to celebrate smart kids when you can do it through competitions like this.
Right.
It's a fairly inexpensive way to get some kids some great recognition. Good. And the trophies we give are ridiculously big. So.
They really are. And I had one other question. Under that section of, let me see what section was that, the very end, I think. I had two more questions. The first one, e-media VA, because I was hoping that we would have utilized that, because it's almost like taking students to a site or on
Absolutely.
A field trip. It is just wonderful. But we use the Promethean board. Does it interface with that at all? The Promethean board.
Oh, sure. Absolutely.
Okay. So then, and I mean, all of the bits and bytes from that would be so wonderful. So it's a matter of us just making teachers aware of that access.
Because all your teachers have accounts. It's already.
Yes.
Oh,
they are.
Yeah.
So they are using.
Awesome.
They
awesome.
Are using, because in the note here, there was no indication that we had used it.
Yeah,
All right. So then does that change how much we saved? How do we report that?
Well, that's a good point. We've trained your folks already, and you've got experts in-house, so you're doing your own training.
Mm-hmm.
Well, we would be happy to come out and assist if they would like more. But no, it really does not affect. You're really utilizing it better than a lot of divisions because you have people in the division.
Right. There was nothing indicated as a savings for us in that area. I saw. Didn't I see 0-0?
The training. Savings would have been around the training.
Have people trained.
Yeah. All right.
Right.
So that was the training.
Mm-hmm.
All right.
That's right.
Okay.
That's right.
Very good. Okay. Good. So then the last question is that of relating to the very last section of your the modules. 21st. What you have 5 out of 21 workforce modules.
The workforce modules. We have gotten into the world of workforce development in a very significant way. We debuted a site a few months ago called Skills Online. You can go online. It's up now running. We are offering over 4,000 workforce development courses in 18 different industry sectors. We are also producing, this is what you're referring to, workplace readiness modules. You know those soft skills that people talk about, the skills you need to be a quality employee? The University of Virginia identified 22 of these soft skills in a report back in 2010, and we're creating kind of a mini course, a module, if you will, an online module that we are going to offer to everybody free of charge. In fact, the superintendents are going to see the first internet use and safety at their meeting in October. Mrs. King, you will as well, and you'll be getting those for free. So we're 5 are in production. The first one, internet use and safety, will be coming out very soon, matter of weeks. And then we've got applied math, researching on the internet, reading for information, and health, wellness, and safety will all be coming out this fall. Ultimately, the goal is, as funding rolls through, is to produce one for each of those identified skill sets. And again, you will just have those for free as being part of the WHRO family. So these can be used within CTE programs. Some schools are using them right in classrooms as a way to help supplement some of the other courses that teachers are doing.
And I suppose adult education as well.
That's absolutely. Yeah, the big focus is adult education, but some schools are deciding that this works for the higher grade levels. Yeah. And the internet use and safety will be targeted really on middle schools. That's what our superintendents asked for a few years back. And so this first one coming out is for that very purpose of helping kids understand when you're on the internet how to be appropriate and how to be safe. So that course is coming out very soon, like I said, in a matter of weeks.
Any other questions, comments? Very good. Thank you so very much. Okay. And I do want to note that we do have a growing utilization
of
WHRO services. We have a growing utilization.
I really appreciate that. I think it's great. And again, these services are all yours for no extra cost. You spend $2 per student per year, and you get the whole list. So use it as much as you possibly can. Save a lot of money and improve that quality of education.
Yes. Thank you so very much for coming
out. Thank you.
Thanks so much.
Madam Chair, board members, we have one more piece of good news that we would like to present, and that is our alumni spotlight, where we started last year by recognizing a alumnus from Franklin High School. This month, we would like to feature Ms. Kay Weaver as the September 2015 Alumnus of the Month. Elizabeth K. Weaver graduated from Franklin High School in 1975. She was very active in the music program and upon graduation pursued a music education degree at Shenandoah College and Conservatory of Music, now Shenandoah University. She taught in public education for a total of 9 years, two of those in the Franklin City School System. Ms. Weaver also worked in customer service and sales at Union Camp Corporation and taught music privately in her home for approximately 10 years. In 1998, she decided to pursue credentials in insurance and financial services and was offered a position with the Horace Mann Company, the nation's largest multi-line insurance company that focuses on the insurance, financial, and retirement needs of educators. She has successfully grown this business over the past 17 years and now serves many of our regional school districts. She is highly supportive of our local school divisions and continues to work with teachers to bring quality and competitive insurance products and insight on financial well-being for their futures. While maintaining a busy schedule, she continues to be a very proud Broncos supporter. Her office is located in downtown Franklin at 214 Middle Street. Board members, we would like to recognize and community and staff Ms. Kay Weaver as our September 2015 Alumnus of the Month.
Thank you, Dr. Bell. Good choice. Mm-hmm. Right. Citizens' time. Do we have anyone who signed up? Okay, thank you. Consent agenda, action to approve the minutes. And I looked at those and realized that we had a couple of where maybe we didn't have all members here, so we need to take these probably one by one. So we'll start with the school board meeting minutes for July 22nd, 2015. If there are no corrections, I'll entertain a motion to approve. I think for the good of the board, if there are corrections, we're going to have to reflect them here. So would you just... Okay. Mm-hmm.
For the July 22nd meeting.
Yeah. Would you please, and I need to say that because some members of the public say that they can't hear us. And if you notice, I somewhat move in to speak on the mic. They even cited the names of the persons whom they can hear at home. And I think that I may be one and... it was someone, one other member. All members, please speak into your mic in order that you would get recorded for home viewing on television. Thank you.
Okay, for the July 22nd meeting on page 2, where we have the members, board member names, Ms. Austin is named twice. All right. Also on page 6, the total of member voting is incorrect.
Page 6?
On page 6.
Under, do you know the motion or?
Under 17, 18, and 18. Okay. There are 7 members and only 6 listed as voting.
And there was no abstention and no one voting against?
No.
Yes, so it'd be 7-0, okay? Thank you for the voting for.
Was that it?
Yes. All right. So, are there any other corrections? So, who made the motion? Was it second already? Okay, so would you like to?
Redo it.
Mm-hmm.
I'd like to approve the minutes for July the
22nd, was
it? Yes. With the corrections, 2015.
Second.
Properly moved and second that we approve the minutes for July 22nd, 2015 with the corrections. You've heard the motion. Is there any discussion? Hearing none, all in favor?
Aye.
Opposed? The motion is carried. Right? Thank you. All right, the minutes for July 28th, 2015.
I move that we approve the minutes of July 28th, which was a call meeting, as stated.
I second.
Been properly moved and second that we approve the minutes for July 28th, 2015. Is there any discussion? Hearing none, all in favor?
Aye.
Aye. Motion is carried. Call school board meeting minutes for August 11th.
Okay. Madam Chair, we had a few grammatical corrections on this.
Right.
And number 4, third paragraph.
Page 4?
No, number 4, third paragraph. We are going to put an SRS there. It's just a grammatical error.
Page 4.
Teachers.
All right. All right.
Mm-hmm. Number 4.
Okay.
Teachers.
All right. Was there another one?
No, that was it.
All right. Is there a motion to approve with corrections?
Madam Chair, I make a motion to approve the minutes for August the 11th with the corrections.
I second.
It's properly moved and second that we approve the minutes for August 11, 2015 with the corrections. You've heard the motion. Is there any discussion? Okay. Hearing none, all in favor?
Aye.
Opposed? The motion is carried. The minutes for August 20th, 2015.
School. I checked these and I didn't see any grammatical errors. I move that we approve these minutes as stated.
I second.
It's properly moved and been moved and second that we approve the minutes for August the 20th, 2015 as written or recorded. You've heard the motion. Any discussion? Hearing none. All in favor?
Aye.
Aye. Opposed? The motion is carried. All right. The school board minutes for September 8th. That was the call meeting.
Madam Chair, there are a few grammatical errors in number 4, where the paragraph begins, Mrs. King asked, we are going to insert B, the word B, B-E, between Tuesday would be. Right here in number four, where it says Ms. King. Mrs. King.
Number four.
Okay, I'm with you. Under motion carried 7-0, right under.
Okay.
Mm-hmm. Okay. We want to insert B where it says would.
Mrs. King asked.
The sentence below.
Mm-hmm.
Tuesday.
The sentence under that?
Okay. Tuesday. Not the whole thing.
Mm-hmm.
You see, Tuesday would be.
Mm-hmm.
Okay, and a few words beyond that. It said all agree that it would be A.
Mm-hmm.
Okay. All right.
Is there any?
And then number five, the paragraph where it starts at Dr. Hall Leonard asked. And at the end of that paragraph, we can also include students that are identified as at risk or dropping out if they are A. Instead of grace, we're going to use the word grade level.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
Okay. And that's it for that.
Any further corrections?
No.
Is there a motion?
Madam Chairman, I'd like to make a motion to approve the minutes for September 8th, 2015 with the corrections.
Second. It's been properly moved and second that we approve the minutes for September 8th, 2015 with the corrections. You've heard the motion. Any discussion? Hearing none. All in favor?
Aye. Aye.
Opposed? The motion is carried. And there was a set that was downloaded, I guess, yesterday or today for August the 25th. Does everybody have that one?
No.
August the 25th?
No.
Yeah, I don't have it.
You don't, on Board Docs, you don't have that one? August 25th?
Yes.
All right. So, all right. Yes.
Mm-hmm. I'd like to make a motion for us to approve the minutes of August 25th, 2015.
Is there a second? Is it that you don't have it? Or?
No, I don't have
it. You don't have
it?
I don't have it.
You don't have it. It's on there.
I have it. I'm just reviewing it.
Right.
To make
okay.
Sure.
Well, do you want to table action on that one?
No, that's good.
What's the one where we talked about?
This was a call meeting where we looked at contractual changes.
Mm-hmm. Oh, okay.
Madam Chairman and board members, I make a motion that we approve the minutes from August 25th, 2015.
Second. It's been properly moved in second that we approve the minutes from on August the 25th, 2015. Is there any discussion? Hearing none, all in favor?
Aye.
Aye. Opposed? The motion is carried. Thank you. All right. So then that takes care of the minutes and brings us up to date. I know it seems like it's an awful lot, but we do meet. We wouldn't be able to staff if it were not for us coming in for call meetings, and to be where we are with staffing is really meritorious, so I'm glad that we were able to do that.
Madam Chairman, I would just like to interject. We do appreciate those persons who are recording the minutes on our behalf.
Yes,
we know that we've had one staff member who's been out for a while, so we do appreciate your efforts. Thank you.
And I think this is the first time we've done this with detail, and when we get them, you know, I see those sometimes, but I call. And if you call into the office for some of those corrections, they can be made, and then it won't take up this amount of time here. If Mrs. Kindred is back, I will call and just, you know, leave a message. And Kindred. Right, absolutely. Thank you so much. All right, action to approve bills for payment.
Madam Chair, board members, we would like to call our new coordinator of finance, Mr. Jarrell Ford, to approve to ask the board to approve bills for payment.
Mrs. Ford.
Good evening, Madam Chair, other board members, Dr. Bell. I do ask that the board approve the bills for payments at this time.
Are there any questions or comments?
I had a question about on page 7, SunTrust Equipment Finance, $34,581. I understand that's energy equipment. Is that correct?
The energy management?
Right.
What is your question?
What is that for? I mean, what kind of energy management is that? Is that gauges and sensors, or do we know?
I don't know exactly what energy management is, but I can ask the accounts payable specialist and get back with you.
Mr. Holt, I believe, if I'm not mistaken, that is a part of our bill for use of electricity in the buildings.
Right.
But let us make sure that we are correct on that.
That's what I thought. I just wanted clarification.
We'll have clarity for that in the next meeting. But I believe that's what the covers that. Because it also breaks down, I think it's 12 items that are listed that we actually pay for.
Right. And page 17. Cyber learning, $90,000. That's the program that you and I've talked about before, correct?
Yes, okay. Sir. Yes, sir. And what you see here is the extension, because as we went through the first year, we had an extension of 18. They gave us the same price for 18 more months,
right,
of service, and we saw that the program was beneficial to our students and our community, so we extend it.
I think it's a great program, it really is. Mm-hmm. Does that come out of local funds?
No, that one came out of textbook.
Okay.
The first initial payment came out of the CUSAC.
Mm-hmm. Okay. That's all I have. Thank you.
The format again. Thank you so much for redoing our format and taking mm-hmm. us back to the other one where we can really see what the expenditures are.
Yes, ma'am.
Now, we had a little summary that we would usually get at the top of the financial report,
okay,
that would show the expenditures that are drawn down on revenue, the total expenditures each month.
Yes, ma'am.
And then with the percentage remaining by category.
Mm-hmm. Yes.
Is it possible for us to get that addition back for the financial report?
Yes, ma'am.
Now, did we have it on the financial report, or did we have it?
It used to be on the monthly financial report.
Right, it was on the.
It wasn't there this time.
Right. Mm-hmm. On the monthly financial report, I think is where it goes, where we had it, wasn't it?
Yes, ma'am. And we are working with the format. Mrs. Jarrell and I spoke last week that would be maybe a little bit cleaner than the mm-hmm. one that we had previously had. Mm-hmm. So
good.
We're working on one that helped you read it a little bit better.
Good. Thank you, but I do appreciate you going back and redoing it this month. Thanks so much.
Thank you. Yes.
You're welcome.
Ruined checks. Do you ever note why or how that occurred, the ruined checks?
Do I ever note it?
What happened? I saw we had quite a number at no cost to us, but it was listed in several areas there at the very beginning.
It was five.
Was at the beginning.
Was it five? Okay. But
honestly, that's the first time I've ever seen that.
Yeah, this is at the beginning of the report.
Right.
Yeah. I've never ever seen that.
I haven't either, but I. Yes.
So I don't know.
We'll check with that. We'll check to see what that is.
Yeah, I don't know what. It's the first time I've ever seen that.
I had not ever seen it either.
Yes,
and it was at no cost to us.
Yes, ma'am.
But
yeah,
I was
that
just,
was the key.
Yes.
The key.
Yes.
Yeah,
yes.
Yeah.
Right. Thank you so very much.
You're welcome.
You're doing well, and we're glad to have you on staff.
Thank
well, we
you.
We can check with SunTrust to see what happened.
Superintendent's report is next, and we've already taken care of part of that, Dr. Bell.
We got to.
Oh, do we have to? We have to approve. That's right. That's the payment, isn't it? We have to approve the payment, pay the bills. Yes. Is there a motion?
I move that we pay the bills. Listed all this month's financial report.
And I second.
It's probably moved in second. That we approve the payment of the bills as presented. You've heard the motion. Is there any discussion? Hearing none, all in favor?
Aye.
Aye. In opposition? Motion is carried. Thank you. Now the superintendent's report. Thank you.
Yes, ma'am. Madam Chair, board members, we would like to call Mrs. Gurley and Mrs. Jones forward to present the dashboard of S.B. Morton and J.P. King for this month.
Good evening, everyone.
Good evening. Good evening.
We come to you this evening with greetings. Nice to see everyone again. Our partner, Dr. Porter, is not with us this evening. He's in Indiana, and he does send his regards. So we're helping schools around the globe. We have decided to combine both schools for two reasons. Our contract at J.P. King will be ending with our last 2 days for Ms. Jones and I this month. And so we thought it would be better respect of everyone's time to just put them together. Okay? So with that being said, you know that we focus around the four essential questions. So the first one is, what do students need to know, understand, and be able to do, and what work we did around that? We both supported the S.P. Morton teachers with getting ready for the first 9 weeks, really focusing their attention on what they'll be teaching, creating pacing calendars. We know that we have curriculum pacing guides already, but just to plan out all of our homework assignments, our quizzes, our tests, and so everything will be focused and they know exactly what they'll be doing day by day, and they're able to, you know, revise better. All teachers receive this service from us at S.P. Morton and the 7th and 8th grade teacher at J.P. King. But you'll see in the next steps that Ms. Jones is going to finish that with the reading teachers tomorrow when we go over to support J.P. King. Okay. Secondly, we attended all of the professional development sessions throughout the district with the teachers to make sure that our services support whatever initiatives the division was putting out with the teachers so that we are all aligned with our support. Thirdly, we did do a professional development session with all of the new teachers in the district to make sure that the curriculum that they were looking at from the curriculum pacing guides, their instruction, and their assessments were all aligned with the VDOE curriculum framework to make sure that they knew how to build their assessments appropriately, looking at the blueprints and the curriculum framework together. We'll be following up with them to make sure that they are using the tools that we've provided them in the most effective way. Okay. I've been working with both of the new math coaches. I'm very excited about that at both schools. I debriefed with both of them, gave them all of the supplies that they needed, everything that I've been working with. They received that, all of their tools electronically, anything they needed from me to carry on the math accreditation that we are currently in. So very excited about that. And then Deborah Michonne.
Good evening, everyone. Glad
good
to see
evening.
You again. This summer, I had the opportunity to attend a workshop, literacy workshop with 7 teachers from S.P. Morton and 2 other reading specialists. At that workshop, we focused on 3 areas. We looked at the reading instruction, the small group instruction, word study, but we also looked at writing because we wanted to work with our writing workshop from K through 5 to support writing at the middle school in 6 to 8. So we used that information to develop our workshops in the fall, and we'll be continuing to use that information in PLCs and with teacher planning to make sure that our small group instruction, that our writing, and our word study, which is a school initiative in K through 5, will enhance our vocabulary and strengthen those skills for writing by the time they get to eighth grade. Also, I had the opportunity to work with a middle school reading specialist, and we worked a workshop on literacy by design, reading by design, where we did workshops with the middle school and the high school teachers, and the focus of those workshops dealt with our vocabulary instruction, close reading, and also levels of questioning within text. These are workshops that are implemented for all content areas. And in all of our workshops during the summer, from the beginning of the school year, from the teachers first return in August, throughout the year, teachers are doing hands-on activities in the workshops that they can go back and implement in their classrooms immediately. So many of the things we do are not just for reading teachers or even for math teachers, but Collada does for math instruction. It's for teachers across the board and how we can cross curricular in order to get the best for our students in reading and math. Questions.
Also in the same area, we've delivered professional development sessions to the schools. The first thing that we did was number sense, and so I wanted to make sure that our teachers really understood what number sense was and how to teach it and how to recognize our students with poor and good number sense and how to implement the strategies in their classroom to build and strengthen their number sense, and then also give them a tool to do that. And so we went into tape diagrams. The whole staff did it. Our PE teachers, our English teachers, everyone was involved with number sense and seeing how they can help our students across the curriculum.
Beginning of the school year, we had a workshop on balanced literacy because we know that it's important that we're able to integrate reading, writing, and our work study programs. So our workshops at that particular time dealt with how we can use a reading passage or a story or even a novel and how we can carry into integrate the writing part of that so that we can also improve our writing, making the connection between what we read and what we write. We followed that with word study, which also will help us with our vocabulary. So teachers have been trained on all of those categories thus far, and there'll be follow-up trainings throughout the school year. Word study was completed the following day in a separate workshop where teachers actually participated in activities that they can immediately take into the classroom with how to help students with sorting, word families, and so on. During the time we did the workshop, working with teachers with our reading and writing, teachers participated in different types of activities that they too can take directly into the classroom. And I've actually seen some of these activities implemented into the classroom at the beginning of the school year. So we'll be looking for the things we're teaching teachers during our workshops in our observation and in the lesson plans as we're working with teachers throughout the year.
Now we're moving into how do we teach our students effectively and what strategies we'll be using. And so we met with the S.P. Morton administrative team and created agendas around the CASA documents to drive our data meetings, our instructional seminars, and anytime we meet with the teachers for planning. And so to make sure that we are collaborating around student achievement at all times.
Excuse me.
Yes, ma'am.
Tell me exactly what page are you on?
Five.
I'm flipping,
five.
Going back and forth.
Five.
Okay, thank you.
No problem, sorry.
That's all right.
So we also met with the central office staff, Dr. Bell, and all parties involved with our instructional leadership. And so Mr. Edwards, all principals from both schools, the whole Catapult team to discuss where can we focus our efforts and where we're going from here, what we have we done and what is needed from us, you know, moving forward. Dr. Porter also delivered his professional development sessions to each school, the whole district, on helping our black males learn better. And so the strategies were given to the teachers to focus in on how we can better help them. And in all essence, it all came down to believing that all kids can learn and how can we get everyone on the same page. And so at the end of the professional development sessions, our principals worked with their staffs and they chose three strategies that they will be focusing on for the month of September. And so those strategies will be revisited on Monday, right, as a follow-up professional development session to make sure that we are on track with the three strategies that we've chosen. And so examples of some of those strategies are we've chosen to make sure that we're treating every student as a tier one student that or as a gifted student, to make sure that we are keeping all students engaged at all times, and to use lessons with more manipulatives and to help the tactile learners. So those are our strategies that we've chosen at SP Morton. Okay. Okay. Moving on to page 7. We have met with all of our teams at SP Morton to make sure that they have all of their formative and summative assessment strategies, as I spoke to before. But we've also, as you remember from previous board meeting, we created all of the lesson plans for summer school and all of the assessments that they would be using. And so if you turn the page to page 8, that'll start our data for SP Morton, which will lead straight into our data for JP King. And as you see, in all grade levels, in all areas, reading and math, we saw growth, which is really great. And so, you know, that's that. Reading and math, pre-assessment, post-assessment, and how many points we grew. These were average scores that were taken from our students.
This is summer school, so if like a kindergarten student would have been pre-tested at the kindergarten level?
Right. Yes, ma'am.
And these were, of course, actual points and not percentages.
So what happened was they were graded, and so say, I don't know how to go back on this. Anita, how do I go back? Slide it. Sorry, you all. Bear with me, please. Okay, I got it. So if we look at Academy, the SP Morton reading data. So if we look at kindergarten, the average score on a kindergarten test for the pre-test was 45%. Okay, out of all of our kindergarten babies. Then the average score for the post-test was 64%. Yes, ma'am. And so that's the percentage points we grew in. Yes, ma'am. Okay. Any other questions about the data? Okay. Lastly, when we talk about what do we do when students don't learn or reach proficiency, Deborah and I have both helped the timeout teacher make sure that she has a learning environment for our students. And so JP King donated some books and dictionaries for that room to make sure that the students can continue their learning with when they go into timeout and it's just not a holding area. And so, and Deborah, lastly.
Hey, lastly, I met with a reading specialist before school opened, and we went back and we did another look at what we were doing at the beginning of the school year as far as our kids, students who were preschool going to kindergarten and kindergarten going to first grade. We had a pocket of preschoolers who had difficulty learning all the preschool skills. So we looked at what can we do to provide some extra support to those children. And right now, we're in the middle. We will start our PALS testing next week, which will identify students who will need additional help in the area of reading. And those students, which we feel confident will still be, they will be recognized and identified. We'll be able to provide those services. But we also wanted to provide some services to them prior to what the PALS testing is going to tell us, because we have last year's PALS that we did at the end of the school year. So we're looking at how we're going to be working with those students until their new scores come out. So we are really looking at that small pocket of students from that time. We have approximately 18 of those. So we're looking at how can we give them some additional time before the new PALS testing takes place. The second thing is we're looking at the students who are first graders going to second grade. Those students who in first grade go to second, we have a pocket of those students who by no fault of their own had several teachers during that first grade year. So they mm-hmm. had some pockets in that year that we knew that we would need to fill. Mm-hmm. Some of those students were in summer school, but not all of them. But we were able to recapture some of that time in summer school remediation of the skills that they did not receive. So we're looking at what are we going to give them extra time before they even take the PALS, get identified again for fall support. What can we do with them? So we're looking at providing that extra time with them for tutors. The PALS tutors are coming in starting on Monday, starting with testing, but we're also doing some remediation of those students to catch them up from the skills that they did not receive, the support they did not receive as kindergartners and first grade. Kindergarten and first grade last year.
Okay. So these are kindergarten going into first grade and first grade. So they're rising first graders and rising second graders.
Rising kindergartners.
So they were bright starts last year.
Bright starts students and students who were first grade going second.
Now, this summer, did we have like a little intro to kindergarten week or something?
We had summer school for right. kindergartners this summer, but we didn't have.
Was it for rising kindergartners?
Yes, ma'am.
It was. Now, I know the WHRO thing had that little reading camp. Would that mm-hmm. be beneficial in that program?
That is something we can look into. Because no, I did might not be know a lot about that program.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
But now
that might
know.
Be a good addition right. for the summer program to do that little, I don't know anything about it, but.
That's a great suggestion.
Right. To provide some more information.
Right.
And we do have a lot of things we're excited about this fall because we started our literacy blitz last year during second semester with the reading at home activities you can do with your
right.
children. We're picking that off in October this year.
Okay.
So that's very exciting. And we have workshops, our Title I program and our White Stripes program. We're having workshops for parents this year, which we're really excited about too. You know, help the parents with activities to help their children. So from this, we've learned a lot about things we can do to help our children this year to give us a stronger support for the high needs.
And it seems like last year you guys started, it was kind of late, but the little homework sessions with the parents, mm-hmm. the after school program,
yes.
is that what it was?
Yes.
Yeah. Parent tutoring.
And when is that going to start?
Mr. Chairman?
This year? I mean, I know last year you guys only did it a handful of times.
So tutoring will start in October, and so we hope to train the teachers now to carry that on since this is our last year, mm-hmm. So that they can build that sustainability in that area. But it will start in October. That's our plan. This is our last year.
Excuse me, I don't want to cut you off. Okay. I'd like to draw your attention to page 2
yes, ma'am.
And 5. And my questions are directly related to math. And I see on page 2, the Director of Achievement, you met with both math coaches here to debrief and build sustainability and to continue supports toward maintaining currently attained math accreditation, and we do want to maintain
that's right
math accreditation. So mm-hmm. then let's go to page 5.
Yes, ma'am.
When you met with the teachers and administrators, my concern is the discussion appeared to be centered around the writing support for the middle school and math and reading support for the elementary school. So yes, my question, and it may be to Dr. Bell as well, what is our plan? What is the transition plan with Catapult exiting the middle school for math to make sure that we're maintaining that math accreditation, especially, I'm talking specifically with that math 8 and Algebra 1.
That's
not
right.
just the Algebra 1, but the Math 8
and Algebra 1.
Because we had some turnover last year.
Yes, ma'am.
In staffing with the math program.
But our 8th grade teacher is still in place.
Yes.
Yes, ma'am. And so I think the discussion is centered around writing because, you know, that was our big focus with J.P. King and, you know,
that point that we're looking for, right? And so, but as far as math, I work very closely with Ms. Bland and Ms. Elliott, and our conversations have been great. And so I truly believe in Ms. Bland, and she's going to carry it on and even further. And I'm working very closely with Ms. Elliott. She's shadowing me. I'm training her on everything that I do at SP Morton. And so we won't leave, you know, holding what we know in our hands. We're passing it on. And so they're going to be great. I truly
okay.
believe
the
that.
The electronic information that you said you sent to the teachers.
Yes, ma'am.
Talk to me about that.
And so to the teachers or to the specialist or the coaches?
I recall you saying that in your presentation. I think I lost you. That's when I said, what page?
Okay.
I recall you saying that you sent electronically.
So when we're talking about to the teachers.
To the teachers, okay.
You know, any new teacher that comes in or any teachers that we have that need anything as far as curriculum pacing,
okay.
You know, pacing calendars, I make sure that they have it electronically so that they, you know, it's not a piece of paper that they can lose or misplace. So they always have it in one place. And we're really working closely with our administration, sharing everything on Google, because I know that that's a division initiative also. And so just to make sure that they have everything at their disposal at all times. That's what I meant by that.
So with your exit from J.P. King, teachers will not be able to consult.
Well,
I'm asking.
You know, I'll be down the street. And like I told Ms. Bland, you know, it's hard to let go because, you know, I feel like they're mine. But I want her to be the one that they see, not me. And so, you know, I'm still here, but, you know, I'm trying to phase out so she can be the one that they see.
And I think we have to remember there's a contractual agreement.
That's right.
And we just can't hold you accountable actually for what goes on.
Well, we definitely, until June, so until September 30th.
September 30th, right.
Every minute.
Yeah, so
that's right.
The service that you render will be, in gratitude. You know,
yes, ma'am.
We'd appreciate it.
Yes,
but
ma'am.
But we realize that. We realize that you're here in our system. And that our contractual agreement is now with you and SP Morton.
Yes, ma'am.
We realize that. So I guess to ask for a plan from them for sustainability.
And that was my question.
J.P. King, yes,
that's
if
my question.
If you have time to leave something in writing, we would certainly appreciate
we
that.
Would.
Yes, ma'am.
A plan or whatever that would help us to sustainability.
Yes, ma'am.
And Dr. Bell, did you already have, had you already spoken to them? Okay.
Yes.
That was why we went out and we aggressively sought a math coach. And Mrs. Bland is also in the process of working on being a math specialist.
That's right.
Okay.
And we have another teacher that is being trained to be a math specialist.
That's right, Ms. Freeman.
So we will have in 3 years two people in that building that will be considered math specialists.
That's right.
Very good. Very good.
And very good. Five in your building, right?
And six if we can get the last one in the other.
Correct.
And
five in SP Morton.
Okay. All right. Very good.
Five math specialists.
Yes.
Yes.
Thank you.
Okay,
thank you so
you.
Much.
And I wanted to mention STREAM, wonderful accomplishment achievement by students. It really shows that the program was worth it, Dr. Bell. And I believe that this is funded by Foundation.
Franklin South Avenue Church.
Yes, and I think that this is the type of data that we need to have to really show the value of the program and the that we wish to do this again next summer. I mean, you've done so well with this. I looked at the 18 areas that you had in your report, and I think I just looked at 12 areas show increases of at least 10% or more.
Yes, ma'am.
That's really great. Thank you all.
Wonderful.
Thank you. Thank you.
Thank you.
Good day.
Thank you, ladies. Madam Chair, board members, also on the superintendent's report, you have the monthly memorandum of understanding for your purview. We entertain any questions at this time concerning those four central areas of curricular alignment, human resources management, purpose and direction, and leadership and governance.
Questions?
Just thank you for a detailed report.
And now that we've started school, this will probably expand a little bit more than next meeting. Because a lot of things were redundant based on the work that we had done during the summer. So we didn't put it in there. And also wanted to make sure to inform the board, and I believe you all already knew this, but just wanted to make sure, you know, this report, once I send it to you all and we review it tonight, it also goes to the chief academic officer as well as the Office of School Improvement, because this is in alignment with the corrective action plan.
Have we gotten a new chief academic officer?
Not as of yet.
Any other comments? Thank you, Zarina, and staff. Professional development law, questions, concerns? Instead of the training. Any comments? If not, the next item on the agenda is that a monthly financial report.
Madam Chair, board members, Mrs. Jarrell will come back and present the monthly financial report. See if the board has any questions.
Questions?
What I'm looking at on mine is the same as the bills.
Yeah, that's uh-huh. It just gives you that. And I guess the only balance that would happen there would be, it is a report, but it covers just the actual.
Yes.
Mm-hmm. Okay. And what you would see in October, once we have completed all the land items for the annual report that has to be submitted to DOE, you'll see those breakdowns of percent used
right.
in each year. Mm-hmm.
Right.
So that's what you'll start to see
yes.
In October.
I feel like we're writing checks and don't know how much money's in the bank. So
yeah.
I hope after we get that, we'll be in good shape. So.
With the checks that we are writing are things that we know we have to,
okay.
we have, to have.
Okay.
But trust and believe, there are freezes on some of those other areas.
Mm.
You
yes.
can ask those people sitting in the audience.
And that was the summary that I asked for, Mr. Hope, because we usually get that.
Right.
But with the change in staff, I suppose that changed, mm-hmm. because we usually get that.
Right.
Yes.
And in this one, the question that you asked for, what was something expended or whatever, this report here will reflect it sometimes. The one that you're looking at now, the question that you had earlier,
right.
is that on the given voucher?
Yes.
It might be there. It might be noted. When you have a question.
And the Q's and the money for the Q's the Q's
report. That's right.
Beyond
right.
Too.
Yes.
Yes.
Right.
Yes.
Mm-hmm. We haven't seen that.
And the titles also.
Yeah.
But of course the title money, some of that is carried over from one year to another. Then you don't get awarded early in the year. Maybe some money comes in what
last year didn't come in to around December.
Absolutely.
But you will see the carryover money. And you know, last year for the board, we broke that down into various funds. So you can see that how it was broken down for Title I mm-hmm. and Title II and everything that we have, Title VI.
Thank you.
You're welcome.
Madam Chair, board members, what we have is a technical amendment to the course offering guide for Franklin High School. In the course offering guide, Franklin High School had already adjusted our movement to the 10-point grading scale and what we already were currently using with dual enrollment and honors. However, we did not have the 4.0 scale that was aligned with the 10-point grading scale, as we had to break it down in Power School for A+, A, and A-. So this is a technical amendment that would be inserted into the course offering guide, so it would illustrate that there is a breakdown of A plus AA minus. Previously, you just had A was 90 to 100, B was 80 to 89. But in Power School, it has to be listed this way so you could break it down. Which, and then on this side, you see the quality points or the percent scale that is used with that. So this is, we just wanted to have this tonight so you can see this is what we would technically amend to the course offering guide, which will be infused into the approved 2015-16 course offering guide at Franklin High School.
And we had approved the 10-point grading scale, I think, back in November, December?
February.
Oh,
February.
So this won't start until this year, correct?
This starts September 8th.
This year,
yes,
so
ma'am.
So we're not doing any kind of retroactive 4.0 scale?
Yes, ma'am. The retro is 10-point grading scale, not 4.0. The retro, the grades are retro based on the movement to the 10-point grading scale. So all
seven. We had approved the policy change to begin 2015 and 16, did we not?
September 8th, yes, ma'am.
Then how can we retro a policy without approve? I mean, we didn't approve a retro policy. I mean, it was my understanding the policy change was going to begin for the 15-16 school year, correct?
Yes. Mm-hmm.
I'm just wondering how we can retroactively put a policy in place. I don't think that's what we approved.
We approved when I did the presentation in February. I showed the difference on what a 10-point grading scale would do for a child versus the 7-point grading scale. And when we said that we would not start in February because we would have to change all the transcripts, we would have to go through getting it out to the community in terms of the report cards. A lot of things were involved in changing it in February. So we said what we would do, we would wait. As I consulted with the team from Franklin High School, we would wait after summer school was over, and everyone in summer school would be on the 7-point grading scale. Once we received all the grades and everything from summer school, then as of September 8th, we would start the new 10-point grading scale, and that those students' grades would then be
reflect
the 10-point grading scale, because we talked about those kids not being on the same playing field with other students in the region for the past 4 or 5 years. So this graduating class would be on the same playing field as their other students that have been on a playing field of a 10-point grading scale for the past 4 or 5 years, and that is 11 school districts in our region.
I got a lot of calls on this, and the basis of the calls were the board passed this policy effective September 8th, 2015, which meant that beginning that date, we were on a 10-point scale. Everybody before that was on a 7-point scale. I went back and looked at the PowerPoint, I did some research, and no school that passed from a 7 to a 10 point went retroactive. There was no mention in the policy that was passed of a retroactive change. I don't think the Department of Education would allow us to go back and change a student's grades. And here's the problem with that. We're hurting the teachers, because the teachers, let's say a student got a 92. That teacher is saying that student earned a B. And because we go back retroactively and change that B to an A, we're hurting the teacher. We're cutting into their integrity, I think.
In the region, you are correct. There is no school division in our region that did retro.
No, none in the state that I'm aware.
No, sir. No, sir. I beg to differ. There is one division, Henrico. Henrico County Public Schools, beginning of 2014-15, did the retroactive in Region 1.
How many in the state changed to the 10-point scale, do you think?
I don't know how many in the state, but I know in my PowerPoint, I focused on Region 1 and Region 2. In Region 2, it was 11 out of 15. In Region 1, it was 10 out of 15.
And only one went retroactive.
And only one went retro.
And why is that? Because they can't do it.
No, sir. That's not the reason. The reason that Henrico did, and Henrico went back to sixth grade. They retro sixth grade through 12th grade. There is nothing that is in policy or at VDOE that denies a superintendent for making the retro.
If the board approves it.
Really, retro doesn't have to be approved because retro is a operations. Policy is the 10-point grading scale.
Well, I have a question now. We all sat here. Shouldn't it be reflected in our minutes, the discussion that we had in reference to this?
The minutes say the board passed the policy to convert to a 10-point scale effective September 8, 2015, period. That's all it says.
Well, I know that's what the policy says, but in the minutes.
That's what the minutes say.
That's what you, okay.
That's what the minutes do say. But the PowerPoint presentation that was presented shows the conversion from 10-point to 7-point. Now, as Mr. Holder is discussing, he's discussing policy. But as I alluded to the fact of Henrico County Public Schools, that retro is an operation. That's superintendent. And that's what Dr. Russo did in Henrico in 2014-15. Now, there's other reasons that some of the divisions may not have done it. Chesterfield County, when I talked with Dr. Newsom, he has 56,000 students or more. It would have been, he would have taken him all year to do that. Henrico, they have a good number of students as well. However, Dr. Russo started planning well in advance, and he moved forward. Richmond City Public Schools, no, they did not decide to retro. A lot of the schools in our division did not decide to retro based on the number of students that they have. But in a small division like Franklin, we had approximately 11,000 files, and it only took us about 2.5 weeks. So we could make the change.
Well, Suffolk, Franklin, and Surrey did not go retro. They picked a date and they went on the new scale.
No, Suffolk did not. But that was the call of Dr. Whitney. He chose not to do that.
Well, anytime, let me go back, because I think we're hung up on retro.
Is that the concern, retro? And retro, in my opinion, would refer to the utilization of anything in the past.
Right.
Yes, ma'am. They have what we in Franklin have done is that our kids have not been on the same playing field as the students in our region for the past 4 years. This graduating class would not be on the same playing field with the other students in this region, because that means that if what Mr. Holder is speaking of, they still would not benefit from applications and the grant awards and the scholarships. They would not benefit. They would have to be on the same playing field for 4 years, because most of the school divisions have been doing this for at least 4, 5, 6 years or more.
Right.
So to be on the same playing field in terms of scholarships, we should have, my personal opinion, should have been on the same playing field 5 years ago.
I think it makes sense to change. I don't have a problem with that. But colleges are used to looking at two different transcripts. They're used to looking at a 7 point for some and 10 point for others on the same school system and on the same student. That's all these schools are changing, so they get that every day. I guess what I'm saying is I'm not sure that we had the authority to go back and retroactively change students' grades without board approval. That's what I'm saying.
Okay, so then my question is, Dr. Bell, go back and give me that sentence again. You said certain things were policy for the board, and then there were certain things that fell in your lane as far as a superintendent.
That's correct.
Okay, is that possible to research that and bring that back to the board?
I've already researched.
Okay, would you bring that back to us again? Because I think that we must need to revisit it.
The Henrico grading practice was a retroactive grading practice.
Is that Pat Russo?
That was Pat Russo.
Okay. He went to graduate school with me, so I know Pat. I haven't talked to him.
So I researched who had done the retro. Also, I researched, is this a policy or is this operations? It is operations. The superintendent has the right to adjust. That is an operation. The policy is the 10-point grading scale. Now, superintendents chose not to do it. A lot of superintendents chose not to do it. When I was in Sussex, yeah, that's right. It's a gutsy call. But in fairness for our students, I made the gutsy call.
So my question again.
But also with the research, and I allude to this fact, which Mr. Holt, you did not see in February, college boards do not look at if a school division is on a 7 point or 10 point. The research shows that college boards look at one thing and one thing only.
The bottom line.
They don't care if how many extracurricular classes you've taken. They don't care about that. How many clubs you've been in. They look at GPA because they do not have time to decipher who's on a 5 point scale, who is on a 7 point scale, who's on a 10 point scale. 80% look at GPA straight across the board. Now, the shift in the paradigm shift is now colleges are not looking at the SAT. It's primarily the GPA. Also, let me tell you the other shift. Colleges are not looking at SOL scores. It's if you pass the course. In the next year or so, I believe the state of Virginia will not give an SOL test again. That's where I believe we're headed. That's why the influx of alternative assessments. Because in the state of North Carolina, and I give this example, there was a young man who was a Division I prospect in Harrisonburg. He did not pass his Algebra II SOL. He took it 6 times. He had a 399. He did not think he would receive the full ride that the University of North Carolina in Chapel Hill, Roy Williams recruited him heavily. He's one of the blue chippers. He did not think he would receive that scholarship because he did not pass the SOL. The state of North Carolina has changed their policies as it pertains to intercourse testing. And they say, young man, you passed that class. You got a full ride. He'll be on the court. And the whole entire state of North Carolina has gone to a 10-point grade, which I showed in our PowerPoint how many states who've actually adjusted to the 10-point grade.
Well, theoretically, we could have had a senior last year who was supposed to graduate who failed on the 7-point scale. But now we're retroactively giving that person a passing score on the 10-point scale when we didn't allow them to graduate?
All students.
Theoretically.
Okay. Let me clear this up for the board as well so you are knowing, informed. Any student who received an F in the 7-point grading scale, we did not adjust the F. You kept an F. Any transfer that is coming into our division this year, their grade would not be reflective in a retro environment. It will start second semester because they have to go through this semester. They have to be in Franklin City in order to receive the 10-point grade scale. So Fs did not touch. Left all Fs alone. They stayed where they were. That's exactly what Henrico did. Henrico did not touch Fs. Transfers, we didn't touch transfers. Now, I don't know what Henrico did with transfers, but I did not think it was fair for a student that was on a 7-point scale to reap the benefits of a 10-point scale, and they had not been a part of Franklin City Public Schools. So they would wait to second semester. They would go through the actual 10-point grading environment.
So your feeling is that the change was an operational decision from the superintendent and not a policy decision from the board?
Yes, sir. I stand on it. I know it was.
Okay.
I've done the research.
Okay.
Yes, sir.
Would there be any way that we could see, get some examples of kids on the 3.7 and then what happened to their score when you converted, when you retroactively converted it to the 4.0? Just a
thing. Are you asking for specific students' names?
I know.
With their information?
Absolutely not.
Oh, okay.
Absolutely no names. I just want to know how it changes them.
Well, I could show the same comparison that I showed in February, where I showed a 2.7 student taking the same courses in a 7-point environment, how it affected their GPA in a 10-point environment, which it went to a 3.2, if you recall the PowerPoint. Now, a student with a 3.7 depends on the courses that he took or she took that was on a 7-point scale. It would depend on their grade. So I could look at the same scenario and email that to the board to show you what it would do. However, if you have a 3.7, and it also would depend on where they are in the spectrum of high school, and if they have taken dual enrollment or honors or whatever, it may. But on a basic 3.7, and you converted whatever the 3.7 is, it possibly may take it to a 4.2 if you just do on basic. Or it may just jump on a 4.0, depends on what the 3.7 grade is. But what I showed the board in February was what a 2.7 would do in a 7-point environment, and then what it looks like in a 10-point environment, which we all saw, same exact courses, 2.7, 7-point, 3.2, 10-point. But it varies.
Dr. Bell, I'm hearing the discussion tonight, and I'm thinking, I don't know what the other board members are thinking at this point, but the line between policy and operations, that maybe we need to put that on our agenda, maybe Ms. King, to discuss that more, not just for this particular item, but so that we understand what's policy and what's operations for the superintendent.
Well, see, I think when Dr. Bell did his presentation to us, mm-hmm. and we were changing from a 7-point to a 10-point grading scale, mm-hmm. then that became a part of our regulations for promotion. That became a part. It's not like it's just out there in nowhere. That is our regulation in terms of our promotion and grading within the school division. I think what we're saying here is, and thinking about it maybe,
did we go into detail enough when it came to how we would convert? How would we convert the grades? Because we knew that there would have to be a change. And I was thinking in going from a 7-point to a 10-point, then the possibility of people being upset would be almost nil. I mean, because I think our survey was done, was it not? Wasn't there a survey done?
We had a task force that
yes.
was created
yes.
with community members,
yes.
teachers, and everyone. Also, the advisory council, it was presented.
Yes.
It was presented to every teacher in this division.
Mm-hmm.
And not, there was only one question that was ever posed to me. Were we lowering the standards? And the answer to that question, we cannot lower the standards because the standards are the standards of learning from VDOE. So we're not lowering any standards. Then secondly, my answer to that question was, everyone in this room is a teacher. Did you lower the standards when you wanted a 10-point grading scale in college? Was anybody lowering any standards?
I guess what I'm, my point is, and I agree with you, Mrs.
Mm-hmm,
King,
mm-hmm.
maybe we did not
Absolutely.
Have enough discussion. Because if we didn't, then it's not just the superintendent.
Absolutely.
It's Franklin, this board, that maybe we didn't have the discussion that we needed to have. However, it's been approved now.
Yeah.
Maybe we should have had this discussion, and we did not have it. So we can't just look at Dr. Bell. We need to also look at the board members.
And
well,
then,
excusing you two, because you weren't here.
When we look at the discussion,
yeah. maybe we should
when
have.
When we look at the discussion, I mean, I had a concern because it seemed as though we left the focus of attention being given to students for we're talking about students, and I think that our focus should always be that of students' success. Student success. And when we say that we want to change something and action because a student was failing in there, that student is going to pass. And we know that we are changing from a 7-point to a 10-point. I think that I was a very rigid teacher when it came to teaching and grading. But it was never my focus to fail students.
I think the policy.
That was a concern when I heard that. I mean, if it had remained that of putting students on equal playing field, fine. But I had some concern with that.
I think the policy, rather than being very simplistic and saying
mm-hmm.
we're converting September 8, 2015, should have included all of the retroactivity that we're talking about now. That would have been clear. The board would have known what they were voting on.
Yes, and that's hindsight. That's what I'm saying. Maybe
yeah.
we should have, Mr.
The whole thing.
But we didn't.
But we didn't.
We did. That's what I'm saying. So it's not just Dr. Bell. It's all of us. We did not. And so now we sit here and hear all of this. This is good, but we don't want to take that away from the students. We agreed that...
That's how it would be handled.
Yes.
And we knew
and so
that
maybe we should have.
But we didn't know a conversion had to be done.
That's right.
We knew.
That's
we talked
right.
about conversion, but we did not talk about it with detail. But at the
That's
same
right.
time, generally, we knew that going from a 7-point grading scale to a 10-point grading scale would mean that the grades would increase.
Mm-hmm. And I showed that in the illustration
yes.
of these 8 courses.
Yeah, we knew.
From 2.7 to 3.2.
Mm-hmm. I think if we have a rising senior and we go back and change their grades for freshman, sophomore, and junior year, that's something the board ought to know about and something the board ought to approve. And as I understand it, that's what we're doing.
Yeah. And I think that I understood that part of it. Because isn't there a cumulative up to whatever point for student success every year? The GPA is it calculated for 8th grade, 9th grade, for 9th grade, 10th grade, 11th grade, 12th grade?
Starts in 9th grade.
Yeah, starts in 9th grade. That's a GPA. So, and that's what I thought that that's what we were focusing on being sure that we could report out to universities and other people that GPA.
Mrs. King, we did. Yes. We did, and I keep saying that. Yes. The board did, not yes. just Dr. Bell, we all did.
Yes.
And like I'm saying it again, maybe we should have, Mr. Holt, had all the details right. written down, mm-hmm. everything we discussed. We probably should have.
Yeah, because we talked about
that. But we did not
that.
Put all mm-hmm. of that in the policy. But we did have this discussion. Right. We did.
The GPA. And Mr. Phelps even spoke that night as the principal of the high school. And what was the general view of the faculty at the high school? Do you remember?
All faculties that I spoke to every faculty. No faculty had a concern. Most of the outcry, well, all the outcry, was that it was a good move for the division. I only had that one question about lowering the standards, and then I answered that question with the two examples that I just gave. But other than that, everyone, basically, and even the board members, if you recall, were wondering why we hadn't done it
yes.
anyway, because yes. you had asked my predecessor to move forward with it before I was even hired.
So, is there a concern that would necessitate any change at this time, hearing all of the discussion? We could certainly entertain any motion or anything relative to views that have been discussed. Is there any?
I think it would be helpful, and maybe this is in a form of a motion, to explain for Dr. Bell to write up an explanation of what was done, how we went back, how we converted, that kind of thing. I mean, it's a done deal. But just so we'll all know what happened and how it happened. And
I don't oppose to that at all.
Right.
I don't.
With yeah. some examples you're mm-hmm. saying for the conversion?
No, he wants to know. Let me not speak for you.
I think that Mrs. Godwin asked for.
Well,
she asked for something else.
I just want to make sure, you know, there's kids that, you know, that kid that had the 3.2 to begin with and then, you know, worked hard for the 3.2, and then you had the kid that had the 2.7, and now that kid's got a 3.2. Wonder if the kid that had the 3.2, his didn't. I just don't know how it changes. Mm-hmm.
And it could have been the 1.9 that worked really hard, too.
But now, if you look
I mean, hey.
But if it.
We
if
don't
it,
know.
I'm not behooving yeah. right. the 10 right. point grade hey. Scale. Yeah. I'm yeah. and the 10 point right. grade scale.
And I think what we have to look at is that it's proportional. It was all across the division.
It was
for everybody. Mm-hmm. So it still means that there was actually, while it was a change, mm-hmm. it was not a change. Because when you converted, it impacted every student.
Yes, yes, yes.
Every student is proportional.
Well, I wasn't on the board then, but my sense from talking right. to yeah. all of you.
Yeah.
is that yes. we all agreed
right.
that we should go to 10-point scale.
Yes.
I don't think anybody knew that it was going to go back retroactive 3 years and change kids' grades. I don't think anybody knew that.
Well, I can't say we all didn't
And
know.
I think that I should have been that. In the presentation.
It was yeah. in the presentation. Yeah.
It was in the presentation.
That we would go back 3 years and change
we
people's grades.
We said that a kid would be on reflective. The same playing mm-hmm. field. I showed... The illustration mm-hmm. that I showed was
he
a
did.
Ninth grade student.
Mm-hmm.
What a kid,
a ninth grade student.
What a kid in the ninth grade, what he had in the ninth grade or she had in the ninth grade, what it would be reflective on now if we went to the 10-point retro 10th grade year, September 8, 2015.
There is no word retro anywhere in that presentation. I've looked at it about six times.
May not have been in the presentation, but it sure was in my conversation.
And that's what I said earlier.
It was in my conversation.
And that's what I said maybe about our minutes also. Need to make sure that we're reflecting everything that is said, because that's a matter of semantics, that we're not seeing that word retro. Doesn't mean that he didn't say it.
Maybe we're looking for the word adjustment.
I don't know.
That's not in there either.
And looking at the past data, you got the past data, but I just assumed it would have been.
The presentation, the presentation showed retro.
But I do agree with you, Mr. Holt.
So would you like to offer a motion? And Mrs. Godman, did you feel strong about including that of examples?
I just need to understand. I did not ever hear a retro. I didn't ever hear a go back 3 years and when we were there in February voting it. I would have remembered that. I mean, I have kids that it's affecting. So I would have remembered
that. What do you mean, Mrs. Johnson, you have kids that it's affecting? Let me explain. Because I have kids too. Okay, so how was it affecting?
All their grades are going to change. And I'm not saying it's good or bad. I'm just not understanding.
Not all of them.
And if I'm not understanding it as a school board member,
okay,
there's certainly parents that aren't
going to
understand.
Okay, Mr. Holt, explain that to me. Maybe I'm missing something. How is it not going to help all of them? No, help me. Because I have kids too now. I want to make sure. How is it not going to help all of them?
If we don't understand it, the public's not going to understand it.
Yeah, so help me.
It's not going to help all of them because so many people are going to move up in a cluster that there's not going to be any differentiation. There won't be as much differentiation.
Oh, so we're okay. So the concern, because I want to know the concern of the community, our viewers tonight. So most people are concerned. It's the concern, not the concern that our students aren't moving forward, mm-hmm. but the differentiation. Is that the concern?
The concern is that people that had perhaps a B+
okay.
on the old system.
Mm-hmm.
We'll now have an A- or an A.
Okay, so in other words, the concern is that I'm seeing this. Thank you. Because I really was like, well, what is the concern? So the concern is that maybe those students who weren't at the top of the class, now they're moving closer to the top of their
right.
class with rankings,
right.
with class rankings. So that's the concern. So the concern is not that we're helping all the other students. Oh, wow. I'm seeing it clear. Thank you. I'm seeing it. Thank you. Thank you.
All right, here's the motion, okay? Are we ready?
Yes, we're ready.
I would like to make a motion that we ask Dr. Bell to identify the process used to convert past grades from a 7-point scale to a 10-point scale, period.
I would second that.
Okay, it's been properly moved in second that we ask Dr. Bell to identify the process that is used to convert grades from 7-point scale to a 10-point scale. Motion, any discussion? Hearing none, all in favor?
Aye. After hearing your explanation for the concern of the public, now that concerns me. But it concerns me.
That's not my concern. I'm just concerned because
okay.
I need to understand the process and how it's affecting the students.
Okay, may I ask a question?
I mean, that's.
Yes.
I mean, I'm not trying to be. I'm okay with a 10-point grade scale.
Yeah, we all are.
For the public,
yeah.
I am working on a question and answer sheet that will be on the website. So. The questions on what we did with the process,
they will see it on our website. Which is the same question and answer document that Henrico used when they did the same process back on their 2014-15.
And I think that something, I had heard that before, and I think I would have said that, Dr. Bill.
That's why I was saying, instead of just maybe illustrating the process, but the question and answer. And then if parents have a question, let them come to Dr. Bell.
Yeah.
I think that's the way it should be.
They may need to go individually.
Yeah. But they're, okay, I didn't get the results of the vote.
I did.
You did?
It was 2 in favor, 3 against, and 1 person didn't vote. So the motion fails.
Thank you. Okay. Motion fail. Okay. All right, good. And I think that that's the way to go with this, because all of us did not hear the discussions probably that you've heard. In order that we won't go out there and maybe give different stories. And Dr. Bell has said that he was going to do, and I think I told you that, Mr. Holt, a question and answer approach. I think I told you that because I called and asked him what was he going to do to maybe inform parents. And I'm hoping that by maybe the time that Dr. Watson has his, do you have a PTA? A PTA at Franklin High School?
He has a senior night coming up on Tuesday.
He has a senior night on the 22nd.
Well, that would be I think, could you have it done by then, Dr. Bell? Because it's a senior night. This impacts greatly the graduates.
That's good.
Is it possible for you to have it completed by then for presentation?
It's already completed.
Oh, wonderful. Okay. So maybe we can get Dr. Good. We'll get Dr. Watt, ask Dr. Watt, put it on his agenda for that evening. Because if there are concerns out there, we do want to address them. And the parents directly involved in the discussion. Right? Thank you all so much. Good discussion. All right, the next item on our agenda, the VRS hybrid resolution.
Madam Chair, board members, we have presented the VRS hybrid plan resolution for your purview. Tonight, we just presented it for your review tonight. However, when we come back at our board meeting in October, we are going to give you a more informed research decision on if you should vote for it or vote against it, because we are researching those options now. But just wanted you to see what we received this summer for the board to have a vote on. Employees versus the employer having the actual plan. Yeah. Being employer sponsored and employee choosing to volunteer.
Now this is just for our preview? We don't have to?
No, we don't have to decide tonight.
Okay.
We're going to do some research on that.
Okay.
So you'll be able to make a better decision if we will adopt the resolution or we will deny it as a board. No, ma'am.
First reading, yes, ma'am. So will you bring this back next month?
We'll bring it back next month because we have until the end of October before we have to submit it. Madam Chair, board members, Mrs. Wade will come forward with the policy revision DLR.
Good evening, Ms. King, board members, Dr. Bell. In our board policy manual, we have a policy DL, which is entitled payroll procedures, but it did not reflect. We never went in last year when we went to a twice a month payroll to reflect that change. And so before you tonight for first reading, and it's reflected by the whole policy being underlined, is a brand new policy regulation to go along with policy DL. And so it basically, first of all, defines our pay periods for twice a month payroll on the 15th and the last working day. It also addresses direct deposit. Most of our employees are already on direct deposit. We only have a very few that still receive paper checks. And so we would like to, when we've been slowly over the past year, trying to convince them to go to direct deposit. And so we would like to put this in policy and make it board policy effective December 1, 2015, that all of our employees have to go on direct deposit. Now, that doesn't mean that they all have to have a bank account, because we've already talked with several vendors who can come in and give them those cards that we can upload their amounts on a card, very similar to a debit card. So we would have time to be able to present the options to our employees and, you know, get them on direct deposit. This would provide a lot more efficiency in our finance department. So this is for your first reading tonight. Okay.
Madam Chair, board members, Mrs. Wade will come forward to discuss the policy revision to DLC-R.
Our policy regulation for DLCR, entitled Administrative Regulation Regarding Travel, we're recommending a revision to that policy regulation, because the last time this policy was revised, the mileage rate was still at 32.5 cents per mile. And so our state has increased it since then. It changes with the state as the gas prices go up and down. And so instead of putting an amount there, we've just put at a specific rate per mile as determined by the state. So we'll use the state mileage rate. And our finance department always communicates that out to us, but our regulation needed to kind of reflect, you know, our practice, what we do. Also, any other changes you'll find there underlined, any mileage rates, any travel reimbursements to include meals, trips, expenses. Usually they're reimbursed at the maximum per diem rate as established by the state, and we'd like to add the statement, unless otherwise approved by the superintendent or designee prior to the event, because there are circumstances sometimes where one has to go over the state rate, depending on where they are and where they're staying, where their conference is, et cetera. So this is presented again for your first reading tonight.
And also, Madam Chair, board members, some of you have it on your screen. I can see right here, Ms. Austin has it. But we added a walk. Last year we did a facility walk. The school board asked that we do a facility walk with city council and other members of the community to see what the improvements were with ABM and how we have improve the capital outlays in our schools. So this year, we've scheduled October the 9th for the facility walks with the city council, and we are inviting other members. Last year, we started with SP Morton, then J.P. King, then Franklin High School. We will reverse that order this year and start at Franklin High School. J.P. King will be in the middle again, but we will end up at SP Morton with a delicious lunch that will be provided by Mr.
Is there a bus involved, or everybody just drive their own?
We just travel, and we meet there at a certain time and go through the facility. And then there are opportunities also to look at instruction as well, and how we're using a lot of those improvements. Yes. 10 o'clock, Franklin High School. Yes, ma'am. So we'll stay about an hour at Franklin High School. Yes, ma'am, and then we'll travel to J.P. King, and then we will end at S.B. Moore.
Madam Chair?
You can say.
I second the motion.
By Mrs. Jackson is second by Dr. Hall Bennett, that we adjourn.
I think she was ready.
Any discussion?
No.
Hearing none, all in favor?
Aye.
Opposed, the motion is carried. Thank you, staff. Thank you so much.